I've been affiliated with Baycrest almost 35 years. People often say, gee, don't you find it depressing, all those old people? And actually, it's the opposite, I would say. I probably enjoy my practice as much as any, and more than many, in that people who come to me have stories, wonderful stories, and I love stories.
It's very awkward to become the parent of your parents. At the time, I don't think it was clear that that's what I was becoming. Often it's met with opposition because they're not as aware of their decline, or perhaps they're not admitting it as much as you are. When my parents were first diagnosed with dementia, you find yourself all of a sudden in a very unfamiliar world. You're not sure, first of all, it's very scary. You're not sure how fast they're going to deteriorate. You're not sure whether that means immediately they shouldn't be alone. And so my natural reaction was to seek out some definitive answer to what the future landscape looked like for my parents. And Baycrest was the obvious place, and Dr. Gordon is the obvious person. So I think it's just for people to, or for me personally, it was to find out what the future held for my parents and what my role in that future would be.
Sandy, I first met when she brought her father, the late father, to me, and he already showed problems of cognitive impairment. Her mother came along as the spouse, but she was functioning quite well. She was actually part of a caregiving network. And then the mother, his wife, began to deteriorate cognitively. And through all of this, Sandy was the Rock of Gibraltar, the principal family caregiving member, devoted, caring, thoughtful, never hesitated to challenge my opinions and views, but with great respect. And together we worked out approaches to care, decision making, that ultimately resulted in what I would think is a fabulous level of care and devotion to her late father and her mother. Many of the people who come to me are frail elders. They have needs that include compromise of their cognitive function, cognitive impairment, compromise of their physical ability, so they need a lot of help. And often the family members, especially the children, are very involved in their care. So it's very common for me to be speaking to the patient along with the family members, one, to help get the history and the supportive evidence of what's going on, and also to help carry out instructions of care. Because many of the people I look after are no longer able to make all the decisions or undertake the care themselves. They often do it along with family members. So they're part of the network to whom I address my advice and recommendations.
How I view my mother and how the world views my mother is that the ledge that she's standing on is getting smaller and smaller and smaller and smaller and smaller and smaller. But how she views her life is that it's becoming bigger, and her familiar boundaries are no longer around her anymore. And I just think that that's such an interesting contradiction, that outsiders view the person with dementia with an increasingly smaller world. She has placed such enormous trust in me that it's very touching to know that somebody could trust you with very intimate, very embarrassing, and things that you normally do yourself that you'd never ask anybody to do. I can't think of anything that she wouldn't share with me and wouldn't trust me in, and that's an amazing compliment to have that happen in your life. Hello and welcome to what promises to be a fascinating evening. I can say that firsthand because I've had the opportunity to chat with Michael at great length for about a half an hour before that the evening began. And I also have a personal interest in this, seeing as how I have a 97-year-old father. And so, like many of you here tonight who I'm sure are either in the sandwich generation or at the point where you're going to be asking a lot of questions yourself and looking for answers, we're kind of in the same boat together. So I'm in the fortunate position of being the first to ask Michael all the questions, and then afterwards you'll have your opportunity. But just to give you an idea of what we're going to do, because there is so much to talk about, we thought we would divide it up into sections. First, give you a sense of who Michael is and how well read he is, how experienced he is. I guess I could call him a bit of an iconoclast, a Renaissance man. He's done so much in his young life. So we'll talk a little bit about his area of specialty, and then we'll break it down into the areas of aging, the process that we all are familiar with, then the major challenges that we face as we begin to be caregivers and look after our parents. A little bit more about what it means to be a caregiver and the statistics, the number of people who will find themselves in that situation. And then I think perhaps what you may well find the most interesting, so we will leave it for the end, and that's the strategies that you require in order that will help you as you take your baby steps forward in learning to deal with an aged parent. So, Michael, pleasure to be here this evening.
Pleasure for me as well, Sandy.
There are two books that you've written, but let's talk a little bit before we tell the audience the names of the books, and we will later on. Why did you get involved in geriatrics? And we had this conversation before. Explain to the audience, a geriatrician, a gerontology, and geriatrics. Is there a distinction?
Yeah, geriatrics is the practice of medicine of older people. Gerontology is the study of aging, whether it's medicine, sociology, anthropology, architecture. You can have gerontological studies in all of them. So geriatrician is a doctor who practices medicine of the elderly, as a pediatrician is a doctor who practices medicine of youngsters.
Okay, so why did you get into geriatrics in particular?
It was actually an accident. Okay. I was exposed to geriatrics as part of my training because I studied in Great Britain, in Scotland, and geriatrics been established as a subspecialty in Britain for many years. Then when I ended up in Israel for a number of years, also geriatrics was in the beginning stages there, and I was involved in one of the early geriatric units in Jerusalem at Sheretz Zedek Hospital. When I came to Canada, geriatrics really didn't exist as a specialty, and I was an internist. But I related all back to the maternal grandmother who helped raise me, who was very instrumental in my life, and I always had a very strong sense of her and her as a real person, even though she was a much older person. So the opportunity came up by chance when I was looking for a position in Toronto when I was finishing my training, and I went to visit somebody who I'd met in Israel, the late Dr. Abe Rappaport, who said, "Have you thought of geriatrics?" And the answer was no, but he said, "There's a wonderful place called Baycrest," and at the time I was looking for a position as chief resident at Mount Sinai, and he said, "If you go to Baycrest, I think you can work something out." I did. We did, and the rest was history.
The field must have changed over the years. I know my mother was working at Baycrest as a nurse when you first began here, and I'm sure as your career evolved over the years, the actual study of gerontology, actually geriatrics and study of the aged, how has it changed?
Well, I would say it's been monumental. And part of the change was the attitudinal change from sort of the pure and unadulterated marginalization of the older person, which still exists. But there's no question that it's been brought more and more into the center, I'll say, of the healthcare system, because the reality is that's who we look after, unless you're a pediatrician, neonatologist, or sports medicine. Even that's changed to include 80-year-old marathoners. So societally, we've changed our views towards elderly aging, but in medicine, the advances have been remarkable, to the point that in some ways we now think of the practice of medicine for the most part, rather than the curative, for which there are only a few illnesses, mainly childhood, as chronic disease management. Conditions that, when I was going through my training in early years, one didn't survive very long, now one carries those illnesses with them for decades. And our challenge as physicians is to make sure we get the most out of it. And a combination of lifestyle, medication, all the things we all hear about, have advanced our ability to look after older and older people who carry more and more with them, diabetes, blood pressure, arthritis, dementia, that can be looked after in a way that's acceptable, may not be ideal, but people can go on for many years with a reasonable quality of life. That's been a phenomenal change.
And it's all about maintenance at this point, isn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay, so what can we do now that we couldn't do years ago? In a sense, I want you to give us hope, because we are an aging population, and everybody knows that the baby boomers are getting older, so within a few years, you're going to have a huge chunk of the population, 65 plus.
Well, many of the conditions that, during my developmental medical years, had a very short prognosis, i.e., once you had the diagnosis, you could see the end of the trajectory. And the example I'll give is heart failure. In my early days of practice, once you, and that's where the pump, the heart is not working as it should, developed heart failure, you know, you only had a few years, and they were pretty miserable years. The advances, mainly in medication, but other things that we know, have changed that. So we now have people with a diagnosis of heart failure who, with the proper interventions, can go on for decades. Example, I saw the first use of anti-Parkinson medication as a resident in Israel. And until that time, we had nothing. And anybody remembers the movie Awakenings, of which was a representation of the initiation of L-DOPA therapy. I watched it happen in Israel, because the neurologist I worked with in the geriatric unit was a pioneer in that country in the use of various medications. And it was like unbelievable. People had been sitting in chairs for years, got up, and started walking. And I can remember the first dose of furosemide, many people here know Lasix, as a diuretic for the treatment of heart failure, that before, if you were in that condition, if you survived, it was almost a miracle. And then all of a sudden, this injection, and 10 minutes later, I remember the first patient sort of was looking around saying, how are you? So, I mean, this is just a few of many, many, many. Now, we still have conditions that clearly the control is not where we want it, even though it's been remarkable. So in the field of mental health and brain disease, dementia, there's still a long way to go. However, the terrain has changed remarkably, in that we now have things we can do rather than just watch.
Okay, well, let's talk about that a little more specifically, but let's talk about the aging process itself. Everything takes longer. Share with us what happens as you get older.
I think if I had to characterize using a large lens to take a lot in, is things are slower. All the interactions, the normal interactions that we have with each other just take more time. And as a caregiver, and I usually say children, but it could be grandchildren, it could be nieces, nephews, whoever, it could be spouses, have to accept that whatever they've done previously is now going to take longer, and one has to be attuned to why it's going to take longer and see what you can do to compensate. So something as simple as going for a walk, very common recreational activity. It's not uncommon for the younger person to be walking, now some people do this all their lives, to be walking in front of the older person, sort of waiting for them to catch up, just because the gait and the mobility has changed. Now, having to catch up with somebody is not a good feeling, because that's not where you want to be. So if you're going to relate to the person who I'm assuming you're looking after, you have to find a way to slow your pace so that it becomes a natural slower pace as opposed to an artificial, you know, hurry up, hurry up, hurry up. There's no hurry up. And we see this in banks, and we see this in line where people are impatient. Being impatient doesn't get where you want to go. So you have to find a way to reconstruct how you're going to engage in that. Other things that interfere with the rapidity of interchange are the natural losses that we all experience with aging, such as hearing, vision, gait, mobility. But hearing is one that's particularly important. Everybody develops some hearing loss if you live in an urban center. If you live in an urban center and are involved in noise activities, I have a son who's a heavy metal guitarist. One of my great accomplishments, I believe, was getting him to wear ear protectors, because it's a very, very dangerous situation to have all that noise. But most people, by the time they're 50, 60, 70, 80, 90, have hearing impairment. And anybody here with an older family member knows how hard it is to get people to agree to hearing augmentation. Mm-hmm. But the way it interferes with function is that unless you realize it, you may think what is memory lost is related to not remembering. And I often say to people, if you didn't hear it, you can't remember it. So that whatever else we're doing to deal with cognitive impairment, you must do your best to make sure hearing is maximized. And sometimes, even though hearing aids and stuff can be useful, sometimes something as simple as facing the person, when you're speaking to them and speaking not just slowly, but in bite-sized sentences, one thought at a time, not three thoughts in a sentence. I've had people in my office that I could see what the problem was, because it could be the spouse or the child, are talking sideways. And the person obviously is not hearing, and I'll speak to them front to front, and they hear everything. And in that conversation, the person realizes they're very often talking sideways or talking from another room. So hearing is an example, vision, mobility I mentioned, and the mobility may be due to a condition that can be modified, like Parkinson's disease, or it may be a natural consequence of many factors. So the slowing down and the digesting of information and new concepts is something we have to recognize.
Hearing loss is also very isolating, and that's probably where you see seniors tend to go into themselves because they're either embarrassed about the fact that they can't hear, they ask you to repeat. And how do you handle a situation? And maybe we should save this for strategies later on, but this is also, yeah, I think, something we should discuss. As the aging process begins and you're dealing with the body breaking down and the senses breaking down, it can be very isolating.
Yeah, I could just give a short summary. It's isolating. So the hard part is, one, having the person acknowledge there's a problem, because they often say there's no problem. And they may be right and wrong. And I use as an example my father, who's 98, who my sister and I recognized hearing problems for years. And he refused categorically hearing aids. So once on a visit to Toronto, he knew Toronto well. He knows I work here. Everybody knew him and my late mother. I actually convinced him to go to get an audiological exam. Wonderful young lady did the test. I explained the situation. He's an engineer. He knows everything, right? So she said, you know, Mr. Gordon, you're absolutely right. Your hearing is not bad. It's quite good. And I can see him sort of preening himself, looking at me as he was saying, see, famous doctor. Then she said, but your discrimination is awful. And that's the ability to separate words, right, and make words out of sounds. So they were both right. It's like the old rabbinical, you're right, how could you both be right? You're right also. Is that hearing isn't just the sound, it's being able to differentiate, and the newer augmentation devices can assist in that as well as just amplification, because if it was amplification, it'd be easy. Just turn the volume up. And we know that the worst thing to do with somebody who's having problem hearing is yelling at them.
Right.
Because then they hear nothing,
right,
separate
right,
from the emotional
right,
part.
Right, right, right. And then they're embarrassed because of that whole thing. Right. But, you know, the problem with hearing aids sometimes is that they don't work. You know, you come across people who say, I've tried, yeah, but I can't hear.
Again, we could leave that for a question. I work very closely with audiology here. The technology is phenomenal. They all work, but they may not do what the person thinks they're going to do. They may think they put it in, all of a sudden everybody's, you know, Pavarotti and nice and clear. All they can do is work with what you have left in your mechanism. And there's another part with aging that's beyond the ear, and that's the brain. Mm-hmm. So there's a concept of
processing,
in a sense, brain deafness, in the sense that You can hear the sounds, but how to interpret them has become impaired. And that's a much more difficult thing to deal with. But the actual technology is quite phenomenal, and the choice is remarkable. I recently brought to my father, who's stone, really, and we knew that hearing aids beyond. I bought him a simple amplifier. I brought it from here. I borrowed it, ended up leaving it there, but we paid for it. It's okay. I don't want to exhaust the Canadian healthcare system, you know. Anyway, and all it is an old-fashioned amplifier, but very sophisticated, and you wear with an earphone, and it's like a little amplifier. And we put it on, and he perked up. Now, he hadn't perked up during a discussion in a long time. So there are ways to deal with it, but the first thing is the acceptance, and this goes in many domains, the acceptance by the person that there's a problem.
Right.
Without that, it's very hard to push.
Okay, so we talk about the physiological changes, but you mentioned dementia. I think we have to focus a little more on that because that's the key. Everyone in this room will probably say, oh, I left the house, I forgot to turn the stove off. They're second guessing themselves, they go back in. I must be in the early stages of dementia. So explain the difference between memory loss, which then becomes progressive, dementia, and Alzheimer's.
Okay, so a degree of memory loss affects everybody when you're talking about just remembering something. That's part of the normal, natural consequence of aging. The forgetting of an item, of a name, of a place, or whether you lock the door or not. That alone means nothing. We look for patterns. And the patterns include much more than memory. Although we often say memory, because that's what people focus on, and we've sort of built an approach where we talk about memory clinics, because that people can relate to. In terms of the terminology, the big umbrella term is dementia, which means impairment of mentation, roughly. And that's the big umbrella that includes many conditions, of which Alzheimer's is the most well-known. Most well-known partially because it affects a lot of people. The marketing has been very good for those that are invested in making sure people know about it and trying to find ways of dealing with it. In the old days, which is not that many years ago, we separated the big categories, Alzheimer's from vascular, blood vessel. Strokes, little strokes, mini strokes, because that seemed to be the big separation. With time, we've learned that most people overlap. It's a mixture of both. And the good news, because people say, well, what can I do? The good news is the risk factors in many ways are the same. So that when people say, what can I do? They're for the most part lifestyle modification risk factors. The same ones that we use for heart. Now for heart, people have learned blood pressure, lipids, cholesterol, exercise, diabetes, everybody knows. It's the same risk factors for the brain. So if you can get people to understand that if they can actually make any change, I mean, the old days, which is only a few years ago, we said, if you don't exercise up to 180 beats a minute, forget it. That really was a great shame because it turned many people off very useful exercise programs who couldn't get to an 180. You didn't have to break out of a sweat for benefit. So we've now learned that some is better than none, more is better than less, but you do what you can based on all kinds of factors. And the same things that you would do for the prevention of heart disease works for brain disease.
So for example?
So controlling your blood pressure, critical. I mean, we know so much about blood pressure now, and it's so readily controllable with minimal, lifestyle changes are not easy. For anybody in this audience who's ever tried to lose weight, you know how hard it is. I used to say my late mother, in her lifetime, lost 2,000 pounds and weighed exactly the same as when I met her. Because she was always up and down a pound. And it was like a running joke in the family. She had this wonderful accounting system, which was last week she didn't eat a piece of chocolate cake, so this week she could have whatever. So we know how hard it is to do lifestyle. That's very hard. But putting the lifestyle part aside, of which there are ways, the medications now available, for example, for blood pressure, are phenomenal in terms of what you get and in terms of societal cost, how cheap they are. To think that Franklin Delano Roosevelt died of a stroke from high blood pressure that nowadays you could treat for 5 cents a day, easily. So that blood pressure is critical. And that's why physicians and all of us keep talking about blood pressure, not to make you crazy with it, because blood pressure does go up and down, but to know that there is a range in which you should try to keep yourself and what the risk factors are. Salt. I mean, eating salty foods increases your risk of blood pressure. So these are things people can learn about. The other thing is diabetes. It's very common. We know there's a, I don't like to use the word epidemic these days with H1N1, but there really is an epidemic of diabetes, partially related to obesity, partially related to the way we eat now, which is very important in terms of maintaining heart and brain, all of which can be dealt with. You have to decide on lifestyle. And again, there are medications that are very effective. Lipids is a big one, cholesterol. We say cholesterol, even though now it's much more complicated than cholesterol, but people know what cholesterol is. Some people, it's purely lifestyle. You do the diet right, your lipids come down. For others, there's a biological component, genetic component, so that diet alone won't do it because you have other factors. But the medications now available are phenomenal, that you can get almost anybody, you can get their lipids under control. So those are three big items, all of which are within the purvey of responsiveness. So as that works for the heart, it also works for the brain.
But putting drugs aside, yeah. What about things like memory games?
Yeah, now, I'm gonna get, well, some of the more, okay. I'll say, controversial. And it started probably about 10 years ago with studies that suggested, remember, medical research is a very interesting phenomenon. It's a huge industry. And there's a difference between proving something, the so-called smoking gun. Took 30 years to prove that smoking and lung cancer were connected as cause and effect as opposed to risk factor. The evidence began to suggest that those people who use their brain a lot in certain ways seem to have some protection. Listen to the words carefully, some protection, didn't eliminate, some protection against cognitive decline, which is a fancy word for memory loss and dementia. So as the studies came out, it seemed that the more complex the mental act, the better it was. You could think of it like exercise. If you go for a walk, that's good. If you go for a jog, that's a little better. If you do calisthenics, maybe that's better, you know. Say, well, it's more complicated, it's better for the muscles, for isometric, for cardio. So the suggestion was that the more complex the brain demand, the better it was for promoting the effectiveness of the neurons, the brain cells, even to the point of maybe having them grow, which we used to believe never happened as an adult. So this theory was acted upon by people saying, well, if that's theoretically good, then why not do it? And that means having the equivalent of a gym for the brain.
Right.
And there are places now that do this.
Well, crossword puzzles.
Don't knock it, it's a living, right?
No, it's true. Crossword puzzles, all
yeah,
of those games.
But I know
play.
Places that actually you go in and they give you a 3-hour program once a week, just like you'd go to a gym,
right.
And there are different kind of brain games. But the evidence says you don't have to do that. You just have to do things, and the things that we've identified that seem to be correlated, crossword puzzles, that's why Sudoku's become so,
right.
So popular. But probably anything in that you have to force your brain to do things that you're
right.
Not used to doing, in the same way that they say exercising a limb that you're not used to exercising is good.
So the whole idea is to just be engaged.
Yes.
If the mind is active and engaged, if you're
yeah.
Interacting, if you're socializing,
yeah. Yeah.
All of that's
now,
good.
Now the thing that's interesting, you mentioned socializing, there are separate studies that have shown that socialization has a protective effect on cognitive. So that being a loner, although that may be your personality, is probably not that good for brain. Now, if you're a lone crossword puzzle addict,
right.
Maybe it's okay. But socialization is good for people. And we've learned that, and that's why most of us in the field promote social programming for people already who have cognitive impairment, because we believe, for many reasons, it promotes one's well-being, but also decreases the progress of the condition.
Okay. I mean, all of this is very positive, very positive. At the same time this is going on, we're talking about a generation of caregivers. So let's talk about the statistics here, because I think people are going to be quite astonished by the number of young people, baby boomers, who are going to find themselves in this situation.
Well, I have a rule I learned. I'm not really a computer maven, but I've learned over the years. When you talk about hard drives, they say it's not if they will fail, it's when. And for all of us, we had it about a year ago where the screen went black in front of your eyes, and all of a sudden, where are my knitting patterns, as my wife would say it. I've lost my lectures. I'm lucky a lot of my stuff is stored at Baycrest. So eventually I could find my stuff, but stuff on the computer was lost. So the idea that if you have a computer, you better do something as your backup, because the chances are it's going to crash. So with aging, the likelihood of something happening is high. The statistics are over the age of 80-ish, a third of people, roughly, will develop some degree of cognitive impairment, and it'll gradually increase over time. We don't know if there's an upper limit, that if you get to 100, it'll never happen, because most people don't go too far beyond that. But the survival into later years without it is a good sign, because that means you've got enough reserve and robustness in your brain system, because we don't know all the factors that lead to dementia. So it's going to be a common occurrence. And as caregivers, we have a number of roles. One, to recognize when something's happening and seek the appropriate help, and to make sure that we've had the interactions and discussions with those we care for and love and we may become responsible for as to what they would want if. Because as one loses one's ability, it can be harder and harder to make important decisions.
That's not an easy thing to do, though. Who wants to have the conversation and sit down with your parent and say, you're going to get sick, Mom, Dad. Yeah. What do you want me to do?
You know, it's interesting, because that's what the way we feel. Yeah. I always say, you know, so after the honey cake, do you say, so what do you want me to do if you have a stroke, Ma? So you don't frame it quite that way.
Yeah.
Usually the conversation can come up in a number of ways. Depends on your personality relationship. As a doctor, I've had the, you might say, the inroad that I can talk about a case I saw when I was with a family member, and that led me to think that we should really talk about it. But often it's not that. It's that something's happened to somebody who's close to your family member. And they will say, I hope this never happens to me. Or if this ever happens to me, please do this, please don't do that. There are lots of ways of getting into it. An article in the newspaper. So today I saw the Star. It said the number of over 65s in, I don't remember if they said Toronto, Ontario, had reached a certain whatever. It was sort of interesting. But an article like that, if you're sitting around talking, you say, well, look at this. You know, this means we have an issue that we have to talk about. So there are different ways of getting into it. The other thing is, many older people, in fact, welcome the discussion rather than fear it. So the fact that you may have difficulty bringing it up, once addressed, many people want to let you know what it is they want or don't want.
What if you disagree with what they want?
Well, it's not your life, it's theirs. So that's the hardest part, I would say, in the caregiving role, is how to deal with, even in somebody who's impaired, but still able to make some decisions. Because in the old days, I say the bad old days, it was all or nothing. If you were cognitively attacked, you were. If you weren't, you weren't. And now we look at it domain specific and degree specific. The fact that you may not be able to run your stock portfolio doesn't mean you can't decide what you want for breakfast, even though your daughter may not like what you eat. I had a patient who was in his early hundreds, who used to come with one particular daughter who I knew very well, and he was doing pretty well. When every now and then the daughter couldn't make it, another daughter came who had very strong belief systems about food. She was a glot something or other, but it was very restricted diet. I think she lived on bean sprouts. Okay.
And she would complain to me about her father's diet. I mean, he actually ate chicken fat. Sounds good to me, right? But he was 102. So, you know, it was hard to get into a conversation as what she expected as to the changes, even if tomorrow he became an absolute whatever. So what we can do about our parents, for our parents, is try to give them the best information, best advice, depending on who they are, what they are, material to read, material to watch, lectures to go to. But they still have to feel, and it's very important, as much in control as possible. You cannot, even in a really good conjoint relationship, and I went through this with my late mother and my father, all kinds of important decisions, and didn't just say, oh, sure, you're the big shot doctor, because it didn't go that way. In fact, sometimes there was enormous pushback, sometimes with bad outcomes, but that's life. So you have to try to get them to where you want to go in a way that at least gives them a sense of control, because people need to feel at least somewhat in control, even when they want your input. Now, sometimes in very difficult situations, you may have to set boundaries. I can't come every night at 4 a.m. because you decide that. We're going to have to come up with a better solution. I can't do it, because if we don't do something soon, I won't be around for you to do it.
Well, you see, that's the tricky thing. How do you, as a caregiver, balance your own lifestyle against the needs of your parents? Stressful.
Yeah. I would say a good part of my clinical practice now, which is geriatrics, but invariably I deal with families. And I think of the video you heard from Sandy, who was the primary caregiver of two parents, that I was involved at one point with each of them. I think she mentioned that. Part of what I do in my practice is try to help the children, it's usually children, it could be a spouse and children, figure out how to get the parent to do what's reasonable, accept that they won't always do what's reasonable, and also how to protect themselves. And one of my little dictums, you know, everybody has a little dictum, is if you fail, they fail. Because remember, you're it. And for those who've been it, you know what being it is. It's like the children's game. There's a lot, but you're it, you're in the middle. So that you have to find a way, ways, to protect yourself. Now, protecting yourself depends on the situation. I've had situations where the spouse won't leave the apartment because she's afraid. It's usually she. I've had it the other way around. And you say, well, what about bringing somebody in for an hour or two? Oh, no, I can't do that. Why? I don't think he'll feel comfortable. Well, do you know? Have you ever done it? And most of the times when it's tried, things work out. There are ways of doing it. You don't just sort of drop somebody in and say, goodbye, I'm off to Starbucks, right? You have to introduce, and often it does work out. But if you don't protect yourself, the reality is you will fail because of stress, because of illness, just burnout. And the reality is if you're it and you fail, the extreme of what you're trying to prevent from happening will happen.
All right, protecting yourself, let's talk a little bit more about that, because what enters the picture is that ugly G word, guilt.
Yeah.
Right? This is a parent who's looked after you your entire life. It's your time to give back. So how do you find that balance between losing yourself completely and giving back and being the kind of child that you should be?
I think there's a balance. I, as I've used with my children, guilt is good because it reminds you what you know you probably should do, mm-hmm. but it's not unlimited. There are different kinds of guilt. There's the guilt that some parents are very good in bestowing on their children. You didn't call. But I did call. No, you didn't call enough. Well, what's enough? There's no such thing as enough, right? So there are different kinds of guilt. The most difficult guilt is your guilt, that you believe you could, should do more. And no matter what you do, you're always wondering, is it enough? So you have to come somehow to terms with what is a reasonable boundary to what you can do for your life, as opposed to, for their life, as opposed to your life. You're a, let's say, a family member. Maybe you have a spouse. Maybe you have children. Maybe you have a job. All those things matter. Now, which ones you might give up for a period of time depends. I've had, I remember, sisters, both of whom were very well known, that had two parents, both declining, that they collectively decide that one, the one who was the lower earner, would give up work for a year to be the representative of the sisters to look after their parents, because the other one, her income was more substantial, and they felt that that was a good, either one would have done it, but that was a good economic solution to what they had to face, because they did have to generate a living. So how people come to terms with what they'll do depends on the situation, but guilt, I mean, you know, to say somebody don't be guilty, it's like say don't think of a pink elephant. As soon as you say it, you think of a pink elephant. But you can help people go through what the source of the guilt is, what the repercussions of the guilt is, especially when it's open-ended, and what the implications are if you don't take the steps. Because when you're not able to help, then talk about being guilty. So that if I had taken better care of myself, I could have helped, and now look what I... So these are conversations that don't happen in one day. There's a process.
And the pressure on marriages and on grandchildren as well.
Absolutely.
We should address that.
I remember in my early days of teaching, I brought a group up from Mount Sinai to Baycrest because we had all these patients. And untapped, like I didn't have 1,000 medical students, I had my own group of six. And there was a series of 6 weeks. And at the end, I was taking them out to sort of the final coffee cake. And as I was standing in line to pay, the last of the students next to me said, "Thank you very much for bringing us here." And I thought, "Oh, great." I said, "Oh, that's nice. Did you have a good time?" She said, "It's not that I had a good time, but until this experience, I hated old people." So, you know, like, I hated old people. I said, "Why?" She said, "Well, we lived with my grandmother, who was very impaired, and my mother basically took after her at our expense. And I hated my grandmother because I didn't have an adolescence." And this somehow revived an understanding of who these people are and that they're people. Now, whether my mother did the right thing or not is not the question, but thank you for giving me this exposure. So you have to remember, you do have children, you do have a spouse, you may have a job that is maybe important to you. I mean, sometimes, you know, we can modify how we work, but we all have a lot of responsibilities.
And I guess the other thing too, children watching their parents, looking after their parents, there's a lesson in that, isn't there, in terms of paying it forward?
Well, I think we model, and I think we emulate those that we love, that we see, who we'd like to model, who we believe we should model, and that gets tied into guilt. I'm not doing it as well as my mother did. But these are important. I mean, that's the human condition. And for the most part, reality is most people do a pretty good job. There was a mythology some years ago that in this other part of the world called the old country, everybody looked after their dear old people, and they all lived happily together in one small room.
You mean that's not true?
Anyway, the thing is, it was a mythology.
Not.
It was
right.
A real mythology. North Americans don't care about their elders because they actually move out of the house. They go away to school. They set, you know, that great movie, My Big Fat Great
Wedding.
That the final resolution is they're up the street.
Right.
In fact, North Americans are no less attentive than anybody else. Just our society is somewhat different. We don't all live in one room for the most part. We move. The thing that's interesting, if you look at any of those ethnocultural populations that all live in one room, as soon as they come to North America, one generation, they are not living in one room. They are spread out like everybody else. Now, that's a real challenge. Being a distant caregiver, I've been through that. My parents were in New York. Toronto, me, Chicago, my sister, I would say were two very loving children, but doing it long distance was a nightmare. And at one point when my late mother was sick, I used to think I called Air Canada, they just said when, because I was going back and forth and back and forth. And you can't sustain that, but that's part of that goes into the equation when you make those decisions of where you're gonna live. And sometimes, and I've seen very talented people say, "I couldn't take the job, because I don't want to be away from my family, not just because they need me now, because they don't, but I know they will, and I don't want to make the move when it's much harder to make the move. So I'll stay in Ottawa."
What's the better option, having an aging parent live at home or in a home?
Well, I think the spectrum has changed a lot. Years ago, it was either or. Either you stayed at home or you moved into, I'll say, a nursing home. And the extremes were not necessarily the best of either choice. What we now have is a much greater incremental set of options. Home, and what I see with many of my patients and families. Home, home with help. Home with a lot of help, home with full-time help. My father now has home with 24/7 live-in help. After he broke his hip, little Band-Aids didn't work anymore. If he was going to stay, he's in a retirement home, but for him, it's his home. It was either full-time help in or nursing home. My sister couldn't look after him, okay? So that's one. The next is all the different supportive housing options that didn't exist until a few years ago. When we opened the Terrace at Baycrest, that was my first job here, it was novel. It was the beginning of the retirement home industry in this jurisdiction. Nobody really had that. So we now have retirement home with assisted living, retirement home with assisted living plus, which means maybe even full-time live-in help as my father's. But it's not a nursing home, which is a much more structured environment, usually for people with far more needs, including a lot of skilled medical nursing care. So now the spectrum's very wide. So when I'm confronted with a family that says, what do? It depends on the situation, the financial situation. Some things cost a lot more than others. Some things are subsidized by the state. It's part of the healthcare system. Some are not. Retirement homes and assisted living in Ontario are on your own. In BC, part of it may be covered. So you have to know to navigate what's available. But these are difficult. And usually if you do it incrementally, it becomes more acceptable than thrusting from one to the other. Sometimes it's necessary. You have a terrible medical catastrophe and you no longer can be on your own. There's no question.
But then there's that long waiting list. You put your parents' name
on the list. Well, the waiting list varies. It depends where you are. I mean, it depends where you are and what you want. I can tell you if you only want to be in the home for the aged, you have a long waiting list. But that's no longer possible anymore. In Ontario, you have to apply through so-called CCAC, Community Care Access, to a number, and that includes some with longer waiting lists, some with shorter. It's not a forever wait, but you can't always get exactly what you want. And that's everywhere. I mean, anybody thinks that if you have enough money, you can get anything you want, well, that's only as long as there are places that have enough place for people with money. They run out also.
And then there are the checks and balances. I mean, we've done so many stories, horror stories, on seniors who are abused in nursing homes. How do you ensure that your parent is not one to be abused?
You know, again, I'm not sure when you did the last story. I would say, again, I'm sitting from my view, either because I sit on government committees and this, I would say the standards in long-term care have improved phenomenally in Ontario. I can't talk about, but pretty much what happens here happens elsewhere. It's a very difficult industry. Long-term care is one of the most difficult industries because there's nothing easy, especially now with the admission criteria. But I think you'll find most places the requirements, there's a new set of legislation, I just read it in the last week coming through, that's gonna in some ways make it either better or worse, but tighter in certain domains of how to avoid the concerns that people have. I'm always a little reluctant when I hear a story because there's always a horror story somewhere. But I would say in general, when you look at the monitoring systems we have, the standard of care in long-term care has improved remarkably. Is it perfect? No, of course not. But it's a very, very challenging industry in terms of the individuals you're looking after and all the disparate needs of all of them in a congregate living situation. It's not easy to live with somebody you don't know even when everything's going well. Can you imagine living with somebody who you don't know when things are not going well and you may not recognize them from hour to hour? It's not easy, so. Okay. I'm not making excuses, but it's not always as bad as people may think because there are thousands and thousands of people being looked after well in long-term care.
Okay. Before we open up to questioning, how much more time do we have before? 5 minutes? Okay. Five more minutes on strategizing, then we'll open up to questions from the audience. Okay. We talked about this a little bit. What can we do? Spend quality time, you said. Speak slowly. Can you do a checklist for us? You know, very quickly.
Quick checklist. I think we gave out some tips, did we not, to everybody in the audience? Yeah, we gave out a list, I think, that has a lot of things in it. One thing is you have to be aware of what's going on. And that's no easy without being intrusive. So depends on the relationship to find out if your parent is going to the doctor, for whom, for what are the issues. Try to learn about their medications. You should know what they are, what they're for. We have much better systems of distributing medications now with blister packs and stuff. So the mix-ups that were very common are less. They can make a big difference. Try to know the system so that when things don't go well, who would it be that you go to? Most people rely on the center conductor as the primary care physician. We now have in Ontario, also in parallel, the community care access that help navigate when it comes to long-term care, home care, in-home care. So you really should know, not when there's a crisis, but just knowing you have an older person in your family, who are the players that you're going to have to be involved with and what it might be. I think if you can have those conversations for the future, basic ones, what would you like if? What are your values? What values really matter to you when things are not going well? I did it with my father after my late mother died. She had a terrible death. And I said, look, I don't want this to happen again. He said, I trust you. I said, trust is not the issue. I want to know what matters to you. Do you want us to do this? So I said, look, I've known you at the time, 57 years. This is what I think you would want if. And I reeled them off, and he said, exactly. So I had his, in quotes, living will. Because he enunciated, in a sense, or concurred with what I thought. It gives you a lot of comfort to have done that. You have to look at the living situation, try to identify, is this dangerous? I mean, we live in Canada. It can be really hard in the winter. Is there anything I can do to make it less dangerous without imprisoning my mother? Things I didn't get onto, which is a whole hour. You want to stay another hour? Somebody will ask the question. Driving, right? Big issue. Loss of, in quotes, independence. What do you mean I can't drive? Probably the single most difficult thing I do in my office, other than giving a terminal diagnosis, which obviously is saying, I don't think you're going to be able to drive anymore. I'm going to have to report you to the Ministry of Transport. What do you mean? I've been driving for 72 years. I was driving before you were born. Close. Not quite. So, you know, there are a lot of things that you have to be aware may happen. I often find that it's the children who are becoming aware that the driving's unsafe. So, I mean, these are a number of things that I think people should think about.
Okay. All right, so we talked about spending quality time, speaking slowly, making time meaningful. You had some interesting examples of what to do to make time meaningful, going through memoirs, photographs.
Yeah,
that's good material.
This is actually very important, because it's hard to just sit around having conversations when the substance of it may not be exactly what you want to talk about, because the person can't. So there's certain things that always bring out good feeling, and you should learn to recognize them. The fact that an older parent may want to tell you the same story again. Listen to the story like it was the first time. Enjoy the story rather than saying, Dad, I've heard that already. You just have to say that's their story. It's an important part of their life. Using photographs that bring up memory is a wonderful thing. Good memory is the best. So bring up things that have good memory, which is often reflected in photographs, is wonderful. So having a set of photographs, albums, when my father was hospitalized, when he broke his hip, my sister set up a whole board opposite the bed that had pictures of my late mother, their marriage picture, his children, his grandchildren, and we'd go in and say, Daddy, who's this? And it was like, oh, that's, and it was always with a smile, okay? So anything that relates, phone calls, it doesn't matter what the content is. The knowledge that there's somebody still matters. For those who are interested, pets are great. For those who like music, music's wonderful. For those who like old movies, I often say, what movies did he like? Play the movie. You could play the same movie 5 times a week. The good side of not remembering is it's a new movie, but it's a movie that you relate to and that resonates well. I just watched two movies that I first learned to enjoy with my father. Brief Encounter, based on the play Still Life, which my wife and I saw in Shaw. I remember seeing with my father, and because of that, my love of Rachmaninoff and his second piano concerto came, and Cyrano de Bergerac with Jose Ferrer. Classic film, but I remember the association and how he could watch those over and over again. So you look for things that allow you to connect. And it doesn't matter that you've connected the same way before. For them, it's new with all the richness and the enjoyment that memory can bring.
Okay. We're going to ask the audience for their questions. But before we do, Michael, two books that you've written. One is Parenting Your Parents, that really deals with a lot of what we've discussed this evening. And then there's a checklist at the back that's most useful. And then the other thing, which is a personal memoir that Michael's written, called Brooklyn Beginnings, that focuses on why he is who he is and how he came to be who he is. So both make for very, very interesting reading. All right, so my time as the interviewer is done. I can relax for a bit and we'll take some questions.
I'm just gonna ask one thing about questions. I can't do personal questions. And I also know that you can misdirect or redirect a personal question as, I have a friend with a problem. So I can get into clinical discussions like what you should do for what condition. So it'll be general answers, okay?
And we have a microphone that's coming along. So if you can just put your hand up, we'll pass the mic.
Well, we have microphones. We can't adjust this.
Okay. It's two parts, but the same sort of idea. Is there a professional that will come into a senior's home and spend time with them, watching them prepare a meal, getting an idea of how well they manage with dressing and bathing, et cetera, and assess if they do need help and what that help should be and, like, give some direction? And if that does exist, what do you call that professional? And secondly, you said about the driving. For seniors, they do have to have a test, but it's written. Is there somebody who you can call who will go driving with them and assess whether they're okay to drive still?
Okay, I'm gonna give you a short answer to what could be a very long answer. In terms of in-home assessments, it's not a professional, it's usually a team. It can be arranged through the Community Care Access Agency, through your doctor, and usually the team consists of a combination of occupational therapists. It could be a physiotherapist, it could be a social worker. Different people go out in different teams, and they do a home safety assessment, and they will do a lot of the things you talked about. We have a community team that goes out from Baycrest, usually on a medical referral. But you can get, through physician referral to the CCAC, if you have a concern, you define what the concern is, and they will go into the home. Driving is very complicated. So driving is a privilege, not a right. The age criteria for the test, you're correct, is an age-based, which has pros and cons. It means you'll screen everybody at an age, but it's written, which means it's a very, very, very simplistic test that doesn't really test driving ability on the road. So the problem is, who is the person who notices there's a driving problem? Ultimately, the only way to have a license removed by the Ministry of Transportation is through a physician's filling out a form saying that, in my opinion, the person may, because that's the way the legislation is, not be able to drive. We don't take licenses away. We report to the ministry. The ministry then does its thing, which may include sending them for a robust test, except the test is not free. It's through a private agency. There are a number of them. The one we use, my secretary, is DriveAble. There are a couple. It costs about $500. It's a real-time, on-the-road, computer-based. There's a lot of parts to it, and they're very, very good at determining whether somebody can drive or not. But it's not mandatory. But if a physician reports it to the Ministry of Transportation, they will take your license away unless you can prove you can drive. and then you'll have to go to one of these third-party agencies. But I can tell you, when families bring patients to me, in a sense duping them, they're saying, oh, we're going for a checkup, but my agenda is for the doctor to assess your driving, you end up with one very unhappy person. Now, if you're lucky, they don't remember why they're unhappy, but they usually do when they say, I'm going for a drive, and you say, Dad, you can't. So it's a process, and unfortunately, I would like it to be other. It's left to doctors to do. I think there should be other ways to do it, and there are big studies going now trying to find a better test that'll be part of a mandatory test that'll differentiate better those who really can drive safely and those who can't. But we're not there yet. So those are the two things you can do.
Okay, let's take another question. Where's our microphone?
Hi, very informative evening. I love the presentation. You were talking about photos a few moments ago and pictures. I don't have a problem presenting my father with pictures. I hope this isn't a personal, too personal question. And he does all right, slight dementia and a little bit of confusion, but I'm concerned about showing him videos with people that have passed away. Should I be concerned? I mean, is this going to confuse him more as he sees them on the screen? And he says, you know, are they alive? Are they dead? Are they this? Are they that?
Well, I mean, it depends.
Thank you.
There's nothing like answering a question with it depends. Because it depends how impaired and whether he's aware that the person is dead. I mean, all of us know that people die. And many of us talk about people who are close to us who have died. So I think before showing a video, let's say you want to show a video of your wedding. I'm assuming it, okay. And at that wedding, there'll be pictures of people in his family. So you may say, Dad, I just got a video made of those 8mm, very common, of the wedding. What do you say we look at it? You know, in this video, there are going to be people who are no longer here. And if his response is, well, of course, Aunt Susie died 3 years ago and whatever, and you can try it. And if you see that there's some agitation, when it's up, you shut it off. If they're that impaired, 20 minutes later, it's going to pass, or an hour. So, you know, I don't think there's big, big risks. I think a lot of times people anticipate cataclysmic responses, which happen rarely. Sometimes they do, but I don't think that's a big one. People usually have a sense. Sometimes you see it with a spouse, and you're not sure, and you're that impaired if they're alive or not. So that's a little different than watching stuff with old people who have long gone.
Hello. Hi.
Yeah.
Greetings. Wonderful. Thank you. I have two questions. One relates to something you began to say earlier, which was patterns, patterns that you look for in dementia, which I think we got off topic. But the other is depression a normal part of aging?
Depression isn't a normal part of anything. Now, there are some people who've been depressed all their life for whatever reason. That's their characterology. And for them, I won't say it's normal, but it's their characterology. I've had children come and they'll talk about a parent and I'll say, well, when did this start? And the sister says, when we were three. My mother was always on the sofa. She never. So this is just a continuation. But normally, in most people, depression is not a normal, even though people can be depressed for periods for one reason or another, depending on how you define it. Late onset true depression, what we call clinical depression, is often a predictor of later cognitive impairment. Not always. Some people for the first time develop depression in their later years, respond to treatment, and don't go on to develop cognitive impairment. If you can get a really good history of these people, usually somebody recognizes they've had this episode before, or one like it, maybe self-limiting. Not everybody needs treatment, formal treatment, to get better. There's a natural course of clinical depression. And then there are people who have what you call cyclothymic personalities. They have ups and downs throughout their lives. When they're low, when they're up. Not quite manic depressive, but the family knows. So that isn't necessarily de novo new late onset depression. But new late onset depression, clinical depression that often requires treatment, may be a prodrome to later dementia, or the other way around. People with dementia sometimes develop true depression. The reason it's important, because the treatments overlap. And many people, I have many people in my practice who are on medications we use for dementia and medications we use for depression with beneficial effect.
I just wonder if you could comment on the correlation between stroke victims developing dementia. And I'm particularly interested in the area of a stroke victim that has fluid aphasia and trying to interpret it, that dementia.
Okay, that's a very complicated, that's a two-hour talk. And I think they're having it. Kelly, is that on? Stroke is a very complex issue. Vascular dementia is usually when they talk about little strokes, mini strokes, picks off little parts of the brain, major motor sensory is not affected. But anybody who's had a major stroke has the same blood vessel vascular risk factors as the people with little strokes. We have to not mix up the characteristics of a stroke affecting speech with dementia. A person may be completely aphasic, not be able to speak or apparently understand, but not be demented if you can find other ways of communicating, which we learn different ways. Some people visually better than orally. Some people can type things, but they can't. So the aphasia is not a good measure of dementia. So one usually needs fairly sophisticated evaluations to see if in a person with aphasia, whether they can understand other domains of cognitive interaction. And many will. So you can't just write them off and say, well, the fact that he can't speak means he's lost it. He may not be able to formulate because of the aphasia, but the understanding may. We used to separate in the old days. We'd say receptive and expressive. We don't do that quite anymore. But that characterized the fact that some people could say it and some people couldn't understand it, but not necessarily both. So you need a really good neuropsychological neurologist, and we have psychologists who do that to try to separate them. We have a very good department here, but I'm not advertising.
Dr. Gordon. Hello.
Hi, Bart.
Hi.
That's my co-author of Parenting Your Parents, of my memoir.
And this is not a planted question. How come there's so few of you in a country where there's an aging population? We never talked about this really. Why are there, 800 geriatricians in Canada?
200.
200?
220.
Okay, so why for a country of 33 million with an aging population, why is the system not doing what it should?
You got an hour? Everybody wants to stay another hour? The short answer is, until relatively recently in the development of Canadian medical practice, geriatrics was first recognized as a subspecialty in 1981. So it's a latecomer. So that's one part. Number two, the number of people who actually like looking after older people as part of the medical practice may not be as big as you think it should be. There are a lot of people who like looking after kidneys and hearts as an organ system rather than old people with all of them. There's also, some would say, a financial factor in that, for the most part, geriatricians are at the bottom of the economic ladder of remuneration, mainly because everything we do takes a lot of time. And in a fee-for-service system, which we work in, time is really the measure. So in the last few years, that's been rectified a lot by the fee schedule in Ontario that gives a premium to the age and to dementia and things, because it's recognized they take more time. So I can't give you the quick answer, but the good news is, in the last 4 years, I can talk about U of T. We've had more applicants in geriatrics than we ever had before, and they are outstanding candidates. So for whatever reason, either because it's finally happened or we're doing a good job, that people who go into geriatrics say, they're such nice people doing aging. Because there's